Edinburgh Live keeps you up to date with all the latest weather details for the capital. You can call our weather line on 0891 33 33 18 and know whether to expect sun or snow. So don't delay. Call 0891 33 33 18 today. Edinburgh Live brings you the tip-top guide to entertainment in the capital. For a full listing of events in the capital, call the What's Online on 0891 81 81 18. So don't delay, call 0891 81 81 18 today.
Welcome back. You're watching Good Morning Edinburgh with me, Sarah Mack. Thanks for joining me. Well, scores of local school kids have been working together on a unique dance project in the capital. Children from four schools have had help from a major contemporary dance company to put together a special performance which was staged last weekend. Edinburgh Live went along for a bit of a preview.
You may have heard of the millennium, but have you heard of the millenarium? Well, it's a new type of dance to be precise, and it came to the capital yesterday. The Royal Museum of Scotland was the first stop for Wayne McGregor and his Random Dance Company on a six-week tour around Scotland. In a unique outreach programme funded by the city's education department, the dance group had been working with some of the capital's school children. The workshop finished with an unusual promenade performance combining contemporary dance, opera and digital technology. Edinburgh Live spoke to Wayne McGregor about the project.
Wayne, well, a fascinating programme. Where did the idea come from?
Well, really, it was an inspiration from the building itself. It's such a fantastic building just to place dance in. So we thought, what a great idea to get a group of young people, some professionals, just come along and see if we can just activate the space in a way that's not normally done. My piece is called The Millennium. That's the piece that my company are doing. And basically, it's a fused word. It's half millennium, half aquarium. So it's like a futuristic aquarium, I guess. We're working a lot with sort of computer-generated graphics and digital bodies and virtual space. So it's quite a futuristic journey into the 21st century. You know.
Girls, that was a fascinating performance. Laura, how did it go?
It was okay. But I was pretty nervous in that. And I thought we'd make some mistakes, but I never...
Jade, I know Wayne said that he only had 4 hours with each of the groups. How long did the rehearsals last?
Well, it was an hour and a half after school every day, but it went quite well. We got a lot done in a half an hour.
And was it quite hard work? Were you quite tired by the end of the performance?
Yeah, because we were doing lots of stretches and then going over the rehearsal, and our stomachs were sore. And
were you quite nervous?
Yeah, when I first walked on, I was shaking and...
And did your parents come and watch?
No, my mum and dad couldn't make it, so...
Would it be something you'd like to take up in the future? Do a bit of that for a career, a bit of a dancer?
Yeah, I would do it again.
And what did you think of doing it in the museum? Was it quite hard avoiding all the objects?
Yeah, like, it was weird doing it. When we first got the impression, like, we were going to do it on a stage, but we ended up doing it in a museum, but it was different.
Wayne McGregor certainly proved he was one of the most innovative and exciting choreographers around today. With music created by the Scottish Opera, the teenagers rose to the occasion and put on an exciting, arty and alternative performance. This is Sarah Mack at the Royal Museum of Scotland for Edinburgh Live.
Well, thank you very much for joining me. Well, it's time for my first guest this morning. Alison Demarco is a colour therapist. Now, we're all going to find out exactly what that is. But in front of me, I don't know if you can see, on the table, there are exactly 49 bottles of colour. Now, they're all different colours and they're sort of mixed in as well. Alison, tell me a bit about these bottles and exactly what it is you do.
Well, they're the Aurora Borealis collection. And I have created what's called a colour health practitioner. A colour health practitioner is somebody who facilitates a client's own healing. So they enable a client to self-select the bottles and from then find out where they're at in their life, what's happening to them, their direction and what has happened to them. Colour's very revealing. We've got the sayings red with rage, green with envy. This supports the fact that there is a universal language of colour.
Right, so I made the mistake earlier on of saying, in a sense, it's not a palm reading. You're not sort of seeing into someone's future, but it's therapy. It's sort of a to see people's, so someone can see their emotions at the moment and understand them a bit better, is that the sort of thing?
That's right, and a lot of people have patterns and conditions of lifestyle and they need new direction. So this can be achieved by their self-selection of colours.
So if people choose the colours, you can tell a lot by them then?
Oh yeah.
I.e. blue for depression, red for
That's
rage.
Right.
green for envy.
That's
well,
right.
Well, as you can probably see from the sofa, we've got the lovely Marie-Claire, the presenter from Edinburgh Live. And Marie-Claire has volunteered to be sort of read as such, or not really volunteered to be read, or she's roped in at the last minute. But can you tell us a bit about Marie-Claire? How do you start the process if Marie-Claire was one of your clients?
What we would ask the client to do is to self-select four bottles that they're attracted to and place them in order.
Right.
So
right.
If you'd like to choose four you're attracted to.
Well, first of all, good morning.
Good morning.
Early in the morning for choosing colours. But here we go. I just put my favourite colour first. Yeah?
Just what you're attracted to today. Not necessarily your favourite colour, not what
really?
You would wear, but what
I'm
out of this selection, what is drawing you?
So just to tell people at home, it's not a sense of, as Marie-Claire selecting them, it's not a sense of colour me beautiful and people can come and see the colours that suit them. I mean, it's a totally sort of rejuvenating approach to counselling or therapy for themselves.
Yes, I mean, a lot of people have got to the point that there are issues in their life that they haven't looked at. Painful issues.
You sure you want to do this with me then?
To be cynical, in a sense they're picking up colours that basically you're saying, right, blue, you're depressed and there's nothing they can do about it. And
well,
red, you're really angry and wow, you're angry and depressed. You've got, you know, so in a sense they're picking out the colours, but tell me exactly where you take it from there.
From there, obviously, we're looking at almost a counselling situation. But again, I also am based at a natural healing centre. It's Good Health for All out at near Auchendinny, Roslyn. And we have other therapies there. So we're not just geared to one. There's an overall branch in therapy. I do electrocrystal therapy, which scans the aura, and we can pick up through that scan the disharmonies within people and what is happening to them. And that is also a form of treatment. Nutrition and other things as well, and colour therapy. But this really is, many, many people get stuck, you know, and they need to communicate to someone. So this is the beginning, to see exactly what would benefit them.
So, I mean, what sort of clients do you get? A lot of business people, or just sort of everyday local people, folk who just need a bit of help and a bit of, want to chat to someone about it?
I think there's a lot of people come because, A, they are emotionally blocked, or perhaps physically, there is a physical problem and doctors have referred them, or spiritually blocked, that they're looking for something in their life and they've never found it. So there's whole different areas and reasons. I've had somebody who came to me because they basically couldn't get to their daughter's wedding. They had a phobia about family occasions, and by their choice of colour, it revealed why. And we dealt with the phobia, and they did get to their daughter's wedding.
I think you'll find I'll have a mental block.
And you've also got
to go around the office here and solve a few problems.
Right, anyway, but first of all, right, Marie-Claire has chosen Marie-Claire, rather.
Four that I like.
You need
four
to choose four
likes.
Now that you are not attracted to
I'm
today.
This is going to be interesting, right?
Well, I'm not attracted to this one this morning, this greeny orange one.
No,
so
we just
the
set these
here.
Behind.
Right.
Okay.
And we're not attracted to this one.
Just follow the line down.
Oh, it's down the way. Beg your pardon. What other one am I not attracted
these
to this morning?
From here onwards,
blah 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 blah. This one is not that keen on this morning, and this one's a bit yucky.
Yeah, that's a bit horrid, isn't it?
I
don't like that one.
So, within the reading, what I would do, especially because we're on TV, is to generalise. I'm not going into a really in-depth reading, as it can be very revealing. Okay, so the first bottle, the turquoise that you chose, tends to be your pathway in life, mm-hmm. what your positive areas of your being are, your essence, in other words. And the turquoise relates to somebody who can communicate, and obviously I know that you're in that line, but also somebody who can write, you know, a journalist, and someone who is creative.
I don't know if my producer would agree with that.
And somebody who is artistic and creative. It tends to relate to somebody who is a lover of the seaside or the countryside or both, but a need for space. I don't like claustrophobic situations.
That's very true, actually.
Okay. So, and again, that works also within the emotions.
Well, I'll stop you there, Alison. We're going to find out more about this. This is very interesting, but we're going to be back. We're going to take a break at the moment, so join us in a couple of minutes when we'll be back with a lot of breaking news and action from in and around the capital.
If you care about some of the world's most beautiful and intelligent animals, call 0800 00001 now for this practical credit card that will help the Whale and Dolphin Conservation Society to protect the habitat of whales and dolphins and their close family lives every time you use it, shielding them against the constant destruction wreaked upon them around the world, even around the UK coastline. What's more, the credit card you use to help them charges you no annual fee for the first year, and no fee at all if you use it regularly. It has a low APR and pays you up to £60 when you transfer the balance from another card. But please do act now to help us save these beautiful creatures. Call 0800 00001 now and apply for the Whale and Dolphin Conservation Society credit card before it's too late.
Hi, I'm David Orrick, and this is the fabulous Windsor Court Hotel, one of the top 20 hotels in the world.
They use my amazing 8.5-pound Orrick XL.
And now you can use it too, risk-free, so you can take the Orrick Challenge.
Vacuum your carpets, bare floors, stairs, along baseboards, even under furniture.
You'll be amazed at what my Orrick XL picked up.
Call now for your 15-day home trial. Pile-lifting roller brushes whirl at an incredible 6,500 RPMs. Its ingenious top-fill design maintains professional cleaning power all the time. Call now, and I'll also send you my Orrick Compact Vacuum absolutely free.
It's so powerful, it'll even pick up a bowling ball. So take the Orrick Challenge.
Risk-free for 15 days.
Send no money. Call on free phone 0800-731-9710 for your free 15-day home trial. That's 0800-731-9710.
Why let the boys have all the fun? For women as well. Live TV.
Live news on the hour.
Good morning, I'm Joanne Malin. Hollywood's awards season kicked off last night with the Golden Globe ceremony in Los Angeles. The night belonged to history's most expensive film ever made, The Titanic. The $200 million movie won Best Film as well as three other awards. For the Brits, Dame Judi Dench won Best Actress for her role as Queen Victoria in Mrs. Brown. But the most stunned person of the night was Kim Basinger, who scooped Best Supporting Actress for her part in L.A. Confidential.
I'm amazed. I'm shocked. I don't know what I am yet. Up high. Up very high. Okay.
Richard Branson's vowed to go ahead with his round-the-world ballooning bid despite an accident involving a key crew member. Alex Ritchie suffered multiple injuries when his parachute failed to open properly in a 13,000-feet skydive in Morocco. Last year, Richard Branson hailed the 52-year-old as the man who saved him from certain death. He says they were 1 minute from disaster when the engineer risked his life to stop their balloon plunging into the mountains. It's expected the Virgin Tycoon will name a substitute later today. Jurgen Klinsmann's announced he's to retire from football after this year's World Cup. The 33-year-old German skipper says he won't play for either club or country following the competition in France. And Mr. Bean star Rowan Atkinson has become Britain's highest paid actor. 43-year-old earned more than a staggering £11 million last year ahead of Lord Attenborough and Sir Anthony Hopkins. That's all for now. More news in an hour. See you then. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Welcome back. You're watching Good Morning Edinburgh with me, Sarah Mack. Well, scores of... We're going to go now, not to local school kids, we're going to go now to What's On, the local entertainment guide, of course.
The End of Violence is a futuristic whodunit, directed by Wim Wenders. It connects the lives of people from all different walks. A film director, a couple of small-time crooks, a stunt woman and a shady businessman. The three plots are intertwined to produce a very intelligent and captivating film. And here's a clip.
Did we get the shot?
Yeah, it looks great. You'll see.
Great.
On the other picture, there was a problem. The company was actually
evacuated. Claire, yeah. I gotta put you on hold. Yeah.
I'm leaving.
Where are you going?
You.
What?
I'm leaving you.
Honey.
I can't get your attention anymore. I'm not sure I want it.
Where are you gonna go?
Guatemala.
What?
I was thinking about Guatemala. Life. I have a yearning for life.
Are you feeling hot and Spanish despite the weather? Tomorrow afternoon you can hear a guitar recital at the Scottish National Portrait Gallery. The beautiful surroundings will help you relax and enjoy during your lunch break. Best of all, this one's free. Glass Menagerie is playing at the Lyceum at the moment, and you can catch it tonight at 7:45 p.m. This play is by Tennessee Williams and directed by Polly Teal from the Young Vic in London. This classic is on until Saturday the 7th of February. Whoever said the weekend ended on Sunday? Tonight at the Subway West End, there's a club on directed towards students. The music varies between 60s and 90s, and if you want to start early, the doors open at 4 p.m. The cheap booze is guaranteed to keep you oiled all evening. And that's What's On, Where It's On, in the Capital.
Welcome back. Well, let's find out what the weather and travel has in store for us today. Here's our one and only Edgar Forbes with Edinburgh Live's update.
Edinburgh Live's weather and travel is brought to you in association with QuickFit. Well, very good morning to you. And Edinburgh seems to have escaped the worst of the weather, with the north and definitely down the borders, especially along the east coast, having seen a lot of terrible gales and snowstorms over the night. These winds are still affecting the fourth road bridge behind us here a bit, so high-sided vehicles might be prevented from going across, and we expect more winds, especially some of the ones which have been in central Scotland, are going to drift down towards the actual southeast of the country and pose problems. Now, if we look at the satellite picture, we can see here that across Scotland, especially, that we can see that pressure which is bringing these severe gales and that snow across the country. That's driving down. So the bad news is that there's a lot of it. The good news is that it is gradually moving southwards. And hopefully that over the course of the day, certainly by tonight, that the worst of it should have moved on. Although a cold front is forecast, so we might see some more, but not as severe as we've seen in some parts of the country overnight. But as I've said, Edinburgh's escaped the worst. So if we look at the temperatures in the capital, now it's hanging about 3 degrees centigrade, which is certainly a lot warmer than in other parts. So we're quite lucky. However, the three kites there representing a strong wind. So we're going to see more blustery gales throughout the day, and that will also drive some of these showers which we've had through the night across the capital, making things a bit wet, a bit cold, and a bit blowy. So take care and wrap up warm if you're going out there. Well, let's look at the travel news. Well, in the centre of town, there's some restrictions. Thistle Street Lane is closed, and that'll be closed probably till mid-February there. So if you're taking a shortcut or need to do deliveries there, avoid that area or find an alternative route. Also, you can see down here in Lothian Road, there are restrictions with some roadworks in place there. Other than that, the city centre is looking a bit busy this morning. The usual Monday morning traffic making its way through. As you can see, the main arteries coming in from the west and also the east from London Road, Upleith Walk there as well, traffic filtering through from the A1. So quite busy. That's also reflected. We look at the wider picture coming in from the Forth Road Bridge there as well, along the A90. Things quite busy this morning as well. At the A70, there's some roadworks there causing some restrictions, and also there are traffic light works in Dalkeith, which are posing a few problems with traffic coming in from the south there too. But generally, it is quite busy, consistent with a Monday morning. However, with those winds, traffic will be slowed down quite a bit, as some of the roads and motorways are exposed coming into the capital. That's all the weather and travel news just now. More news coming up.
Hi there, welcome back. Well, joining us again, of course, is our studio guest for the next half hour. It's Alison Demarco. Now, Alison, before we went away to the break, we started analysing Mary Claire, who's here in the sofa. We found a lot of interesting facts out about Mary Claire so far, but I don't think anyone else would volunteer to do it. But tell us a bit about how you got into doing this and the training, etc. You were talking about it before we went away.
Well, about 9 years ago, mysteriously, I suddenly became ill. I had a very increased heart rate, and there wasn't anybody, A, who listened to me, and B, did anything about it. Eventually they did take me into hospital and told me I had food poisoning. And then after that, I released myself. And after that, eventually, about 2-3 months later, they put me on a heart monitor and then gave me beta blockers, but I wasn't clear why. And I went down the road of self-discovery of why was this happening to me? Why did I have a heart rate peaking to 150? I found an aromatherapist and someone I could talk to, and began to reveal the patterns and conditions that had happened to me in my life and that had really had such a devastating effect, and then realised what I was suffering from was fears, anxieties and panic attacks. So that's really how I was very lucky at that point to meet with Vicky Wall, and she had a colour system that, you know, she had created. So I was very lucky to have met with her.
Did you go to her?
No, she happened to be in Edinburgh. From England. Uh-huh. And she happened to be at an exhibition. And I was lucky to meet with her. And even more lucky to have trained with her. She died about 5 years ago now, and was an absolutely remarkable lady who, prior to her death, asked to see me and said that I would create my own colour system. And a good few years later, eventually that did happen. And I got in touch with a research scientist, and we created the colour, the Aurora Borealis collection.
So it was something that you said before that you felt you had a calling for rather than a career move.
Most definitely. I mean, I believe very, very much that this had happened to me for a reason, and I had to find it. And after that, I also felt very strongly, and by a string of miracles that you just couldn't believe, realised and was told I had to create a natural healing and spiritual development centre. In the process of that, the property fell into my hands. It was an amazing story, but I almost went bankrupt. My bank manager, who was absolutely brilliant, saved me and still is.
Good old bank manager.
Absolutely, you know. And supported me the whole way when nobody else really did. And the centre's out at Auchendinny, and it has gradually progressed and been created along with this system. The actual system of choosing the colour is called the colour profile analysis. That's the CPA on the bottom. Mm-hmm.
Now, just to go back to Mary Claire, because it's quite interesting. You've got 49 here. These are the four that Mary Claire, I don't know if you can see them here. These are the four that Mary Claire have chosen, and these are the four that Mary Claire has discarded, the ones that she doesn't like. Now, you've got 49 bottles. Do you always have the same colours? Do you add to them the whole time?
No. They're a set. And basically, the students and the practitioners who have trained with me, obviously they buy their own sets, And they have the availability to say, look, I want to change a bottle. I'd like my own colour. I can do the same, but they're sold in a set of 49. And therefore, people know what they're getting, and that's it. You know, it's a fixed price. There's no add-ons. There will never be 50 made.
Okay. So if we're going to return to the colours that you were looking at for Marie Claire, if we can have this camera again, and we can have a look at down at these four here. So we've got a turquoise, a purplish, a clear over red. Yeah. It looks as though, as Marie Claire said, the bottle's half empty, but it's not. It's actually a clear over red, and it's a mixture of
oil and water,
oil and water plus the colour enhancer, right? And then we've got a sort of minty, slightly liqueur, grenadine. You know that nice. Drink them later on. And then the four that she doesn't like, I can't even start to explain them. Like,
okay. But you said I have to pick another one. Why was that?
Well, because it would be better if you pick another one first, and then I'll tell you if you can choose
any
one that you're attracted
to.
Yeah.
Okay, this one is that's not one. I'll just change I'll probably change the whole reading now. Sorry. Oh dear, it's like choosing sweeties
in a
shop.
Because they all look quite different, but they're all quite different and probably known wheat, aren't they?
Yeah, they all have colours on top of them, which sometimes, do you see that when you really can't see? It's like purple and blue. Right, okay, attracted to a colour. This one.
Yellow.
Okay.
Just like the sun, Sarah.
Just like the sun. Bright and breezy. Okay, so she's chosen the fifth one. So you can resume your analysis.
What I would say, the reason is that the first bottle should match with the last bottle. And as you see, in a colour. And it doesn't. And it still doesn't. So the last two combinations tend to denote and relate to perhaps a change of direction, but that can be in your emotions. The yellow is also for the central nervous system, for stress, for tension, and to go back to this dark indigo color, and
which is this
that one, yeah,
one.
And the green and the pink,
it's lovely
behind it. It relates very much to someone who's intuitive, can be spiritual, or interested in the spiritual side of life. It can denote depression or on a soul's level, as if you're searching for something or you're looking for something. And that kind of matches up with the end of the reading, you know, this looking for something, change of direction. The back row does relate to the emotions, and I would think that on an emotional level there has been some relationship, either split up or trauma, that has made you feel ungrounded. And again, with the violet and the red in this bottle here can relate to a lot of unwanted thoughts or high energy in the head area, which again goes with stress, tension, and perhaps headaches or insomnia, the like. And I think that whatever this relationship is has created communication trauma between and about. But there's a sense for you of a need to look at the relationships and the patterns and conditions, but also a need for space, very much so, and breathing.
Space, I like the idea of space.
And the countryside, or perhaps Tai Chi would benefit you. And the last bottle is yellow.
I can't imagine my idea doing Tai Chi, I must admit.
It would be very good for her because...
then I could chop all my emotions like...
I know, exactly.
The green is the emotions, the seat of the soul and the heart area. So it would be very beneficial for some kind of walking or exercise or breathing. And Tai Chi just happens to be very balancing for that. And the yellow is relating to stress, the central nervous system. It's also for learning, for knowledge. So perhaps you may go on to learn something new.
Well, there we go.
That sounds very interesting.
I'm stressed out. I've got headaches. I do Tai Chi.
And you need a lot of space. Our seat is not far from here, actually. You can jump out every morning. Tai Chi, you can imagine her up there every morning.
I doubt that for the weather.
Well, anyway, we're going to come back to this. We're going to go out to a break now, but join me in a couple of minutes.
Edinburgh Live.
Daily brings you the tip-top guide to entertainment in the capital. For a full listing of events in the capital, call the What's On line on 0891 81 81 18. So don't delay, call 0891 81 81 18 today.
Looking for something that little bit different at an affordable price? Then look no further than Femme Fatale in Cooper 5. We have an extensive range of latest designer fashions, from exquisite evening wear to smart suits at fantastic prices. You'll be amazed. Femme Fatale, 15 to 17 Crossgate in Cooper 5. Only 20 minutes from Perth and Dundee and 30 minutes from the Forth Road Bridge. Clothes you would die for.
Will the cards reveal your future? Listen to Cablecom's Tarot Line to find out what could be in the cards for your star sign in the coming months.
Call now and find out what the future may have in store for you. Dial 0891 600 516.
When it's a special offer in farm foods, they're not kidding. I mean, look at that. Best back bacon, 99p.
Hi, I'm David Orrick, and this is the fabulous Windsor Court Hotel, one of the top 20 hotels in the world.
They use my amazing 8.5-pound Orrick XL.
And now you can use it too, risk-free, so you can take the Orrick Challenge.
Vacuum your carpets, bare floors, stairs, along baseboards, even under furniture.
You'll be amazed at what my Orrick XL picked up.
Call now for your 15-day home trial. Pile lifting roller brushes whirl at an incredible 6,500 RPMs. Its ingenious top fill design maintains professional cleaning power all the time. Call now and I'll also send you my Orrick compact vacuum absolutely free.
It's so powerful it'll even pick up a bowling ball. So take the Orrick challenge.
Risk free for 15 days.
Send no money. Call on free phone 0800 783 0800 for your free 15-day home trial. That's 0800 783 0800.
Received a check and need cash quickly? Then come into Checkpoint. We operate a unique check cashing service if you don't have or don't want to use your bank account. Just bring along three pieces of identification, like a driver's license, an allowance book, and a bill from your address. You'll then be issued with your new identification card, free of charge. Free phone 0800 24 30 28 to find out where there's a checkpoint near you.
Edinburgh Live brings you the best in sporting action from across the capital. For the latest sports news and information on capital club action, call our sports line on 0891 11 11 18. Don't delay. Call 0891 11 11 18 today.
Welcome back. You're watching Good Morning Edinburgh with me, Sarah Mack. Thanks for joining me. Well, scores of students from across the globe have been flocking to the capital in a bid to learn more about the art of brewing. Edinburgh has the only school of brewing technology in the country, and Edinburgh Live went out to find out more.
Brewing is an art that's thousands of years old. Just a simple mixture of grains, hops, sugar and water produces a liquid that people can and do fall in love with. But now the Chinese, all 1.2 billion of them, have developed a taste for beer and lager. These students have come to the capital to study the way we brew. Here in the UK's only brewing school in Heriot Watt University, the subject's taught as a science. Every single aspect of the raw materials and processes that go into the humble pint is examined. But the Chinese are here for other reasons as well.
Well, you know, our ways is just to tell the difference, you know, between the other barleys and UK barley, and also we want to learn something about British, you know, British style brewing. Yeah, and also, you know, this trip is not kind of just visiting and study and have a good time. And another objective is a kind of a culture education, so we can tell, you know, the difference between the two kind of cultures.
Beer drinking in China has increased by over 400% in the last 15 years. Its huge popularity means that China now has to import huge amounts of grain. Britain and the Lothians, with its grain-producing farms, could cash in if the Chinese like the quality of our raw materials. Professor Jeff Palmer is the capital's brewing guru.
Now, China is one of the biggest beer producers in the world, but they only produce half the amount of barley they require to make malt, and thus must import nearly 1 million tons of barley. At the present time, they do not import any barley from the United Kingdom, and that is just historical. What we're trying to do is to try and tell them that our barley is as good as anybody else's, but also they are interested in our technology and our education.
If Edinburgh's brewing traditions rub off on our Chinese visitors, we could one day see people in Shanghai sipping 80 shilling or swigging back stout. This is Matt Fordy for Edinburgh Live at the International Centre for Brewing and Distilling.
Welcome back. You're watching Edinburgh. Good morning, Edinburgh, with me, Sarah Mack, and Mary-Claire McManus is in the studio as well, joining us. We also have our studio guest, Alison Demarco. Now, before the break, Alison is a colour therapist. We're looking at the colours, analysing Mary-Claire very closely. Now, Alison just told us in the break that she's also douses in a telepathy as such, and during that VT, she was just showing us a bit about what you did. Now, you're going to do a bit of this now on Mary-Claire, aren't you, so to speak? Tell us how you're going to, if you want to lead us through the process of what you just did before we came back on camera.
Well, dowsing is ancient. It's even mentioned in the Bible, is ancient. And we have water diviners. However, the way I use dowsing is that when somebody comes for a reading, it's very important for me to know where the reading starts and what we're talking about. And what are the main issues and areas that are relating to this person that they need to look at, and quite often they don't know. And this can come in especially when there's been abuse. So by dowsing, which is telepathy, we can bring out the right age that the reading is relating to.
Can you go back?
So you were talking about telepathy and dowsing, mm-hmm. and we did it a bit before we came back off that mm-hmm. package. So why did you tell me to uncross?
Okay.
And why did you say it was quite hard to do in a studio?
Well, because we have what's called the electromagnetic field. It surrounds us all, the aura. And very high electricity can interfere with it and can change the responses. And that's why a lot of dowsers who go on TV basically get it wrong, because the electricity is interfering with their electromagnetic field. Quite often, when people are involved with healing, and they're not getting rid of their energy as such, it's building up, they can pop light bulbs and electric shocks. So by crossing your legs, you're actually crossing the aura. So you're crossing the yes response or the positive side with the negative,
okay.
and therefore you'll get gobbledygook. So
okay.
when I'm trying to pick up on someone on a telepathic level, I've got to be relatively clear of electricity, high energy levels, and also make sure that I don't have my legs crossed, and nor do you, because we're looking for answers, two answers. We're looking for a yes answer to a question and a no answer
right,
to a question.
Right, so how do we...
Well, I hold...
It's just explain, you take this chain from Mary-Claire,
yeah.
you can use any chain.
There are dowsing instruments which tend to be sold as such. You know, you've got to buy a dowser.
Okay.
You can douse with anything. I mean, I've doused with my whisk in the kitchen because it was urgent. So you can actually douse with
urgent.
Absolutely.
I like that.
Oh dear.
Absolutely.
The souffle is going wrong.
Absolutely. Well, it's amazing if you douse even dishes and you douse out the herbs for them. How fantastic. You would think you wouldn't combine a certain
I'll never
herb.
Look at a wooden spoon the same.
I know. Right, let's continue.
Okay, so you hold a weighted object, and what we need to do is firstly find my own answers. So I need to have a yes. So moving in that direction is my yes, and moving in that direction is my no. It probably does look like my hand's moving, but it's the weight of this chain. So I then need to make a link with whomever I'm going to be dowsing, because it's telepathy. I'm absolutely, out of all the research I've ever done and worked with this for 9 years, so I would hold my hand up to the person and then begin to ask, for example, when does this reading start? Okay, is this reading to do with something recent? And I'm getting a yes for that. So I'm going to ask how many years ago that is relevant. Is it within the last 5 years? And I'm getting a yes to that. Is it 5 years? I'm getting no. Four, three, and I'm getting two. So is two significant?
I would say two, yes.
Okay, so, and then we can then go through and see if there's any more dates that are significant. And again, I would be getting feedback and saying, okay, you know, this is what happened, these are what the colours are saying, and we'd be discussing it. But
we're going to have to take a break now, but we're going to come back to this. Join us after the break and the weather in Norwegian in a couple of minutes. So join us if you can.
We're now going to look at some treatments that we actually promote here at the Academy. The first one is electrocrystal therapy.
Electrocrystal therapy involves electromagnetically stimulating crystals that have an electrical colour properties placed in a conductive liquid within a glass electrode. This equipment scans a person's subtle energy field to find out whether or not it is in a state of energetic high flux or in a state of low energy density. The colour intensities and graduations give us information on the person's energy field. Then the practitioner will balance the appropriate chakras and organs by using tranquilizing or stimulating frequencies through the electrocrystal unit. By using a modified video camera linked to a computer with a special program that analyzes light emanating from the person, a color printout is achieved.
Here we have a selection of daylight light boxes. These are very effective with people who are suffering from SED.
The importance of natural daylight is that it is energy. In winter, we become light starved, which triggers more of the sleep hormone melatonin, which makes us sleep more and causes depression, commonly known as SAD, SAD, seasonal affective disorder. Research has proved that patients treated with natural daylight therapy has positive results in maintaining their energy level, attitude and health. Here at the Academy, we also use naturally dyed coloured silks to cover our daylight treatment boxes. This creates the desired effect. Colours of Light is a colour light therapy unit purposely designed for colour therapists and others who are aware of the powerful healing effects of light and colour. 9 interchangeable coloured sleeves are supplied, including 7 chakra colours plus pink and turquoise. Additional colour sleeves are available on request. This is a colour puncture unit. This uses acupuncture points from Chinese medicine to transmit light through the meridian system. These are some of the Aurora Borealis collection of massage oils, which is a wonderful means of applying colour directly onto the body. We also have the Aurora Borealis atomizers. These are used for for aura protection and aura cleansing.
Indeed, that was really good. Thank you very, very much. Right, it's time now to meet my next guest, Alison Demarco. Now, Alison is the author of a book, Dark Storm, Golden Journey, in which she talks openly about the dark storms in her own life. She was abandoned at birth. She's battled with anorexia and cancer. But through it all, she's retained an amazing ability to view her life, as the title of the book says, as a golden journey. Alison, it's great to see you. Yeah. You're a survivor, that's for sure. Yes. You really are. Now, you said, I mean, when you were really small, you had a very traumatic childhood, didn't you?
Yes.
I mean, what age were you when your adoptive mother, she killed herself, as you find out? What age were you?
I was four.
Just 4 years old?
Yes.
And your adoptive father married again?
Yeah.
And that was quite traumatic, wasn't it?
Well, that was in the first year after.
Yeah, so it was very shortly after
her death.
Right.
Yes.
And how did you get on with the stepmother?
We really didn't get on very well at all, you know. There was jealousy, it was difficult, you know, it was very difficult for her, and it was very difficult for me.
Right, so that was very, very hard for you
yes.
at that time. What were you like as a child growing up then? What sort of problems did you face?
I always really perceived myself as being different, and was always told I was different. I had lots of energy, was always in trouble, and was always doing things that I shouldn't have been doing.
Right, and you also had this ability, you were telling me about, being able to see people's aura, or see lights around people, which you thought everybody so that as you would, if something happens to you as a child, you think everybody else is the same, don't you?
I mean, I thought that was normal, and obviously, you know, other people weren't seeing what I was seeing. And it was fun, you know, to see all this colour dancing around everyone, around every living thing. And so, you know, my life, I just wanted to have fun. But other people obviously didn't see these colours and perceived me as being difficult and different.
Right. So you left home, and you were what, must have been about 16 when you left home, something like that?
Turned 16.
Was there one thing that made you leave, or was it just a growing...
It was just an ongoing accumulation of events, and I think I wanted to take on the world and do, you know, things my own way. I always wanted to do things my own way.
So were you classed as a rebel?
Absolutely, you were
a rebel. Mm-hmm. You got involved with alcohol, you did drink a lot, which led to you losing loads and loads of weight. I mean, what weight were you at one point? How thin did you get?
I don't know that I really ever knew, but probably around about 6 stone.
And you're tall, I mean, you must have been skin and bone, really.
Well, I was, and I think it was obvious, but by this time, you know, I was on the downward spiral, and I was taking drink, really, to mask my emotions. You know, I was in denial of a lot of things. I didn't know who I was, and I was searching for something, but I didn't know what I was searching for. So, you know, the drink kind of masked that. And, of course, I was out working in a pub, which, you know, I shouldn't have been doing.
Indeed.
And I just got involved in that scene. And it was quite simply, it wasn't a couple of drinks after work. You'd go to a club and a bottle was put down in front of you. And it was a spiral, and the more I drank, the less I ate. The less I ate, you know, basically, you know, it begins that spiral of not eating at all.
Right, so you were hardly taking any food. Mm. How did you get out of that? How did you get out of the boozing and the really abusing yourself by not eating properly, not looking after yourself?
I think that was very difficult, but it was actually my boss who kept on at me that I wasn't eating. He was he had obviously seen that. And I went to my favourite Chinese restaurant to prove I could eat, ordered my favourite meal and realised that I couldn't eat it.
You just couldn't do it?
I couldn't
swallow it? So how did you...
I just couldn't even put it in my mouth.
Yeah.
You know... It's a very
difficult. How did you get out of that? I mean, when you stopped the drink, did you substitute drink for something else?
Oh, yeah. I mean, eventually, I mean, how I got out the anorexia was to take very, very small portions
right.
and
began to drink less and I left the job at the pub. Mm. Moved on, but then of course I found marijuana, so you know that.
So one kind of addiction, if you like, was taken up by
another.
That's
right. That mm-hmm. seemed a better, you know, better thing, but it wasn't. It was just another downward spiral.
And do you think it's all to do with your childhood, the fact that you had this kind of bad relationship with your stepmother, and maybe this other relationship with your adoptive father, which was very strained, as you mm-hmm. said. Did you think it's to do with that? It goes back to
Well, I think that was partly it, that mm. I was always searching. And in those days, I was always... I had this dream of who my mother was. And, of course, she was my real mother, you know, my blood mother. Yes. And it was the fairy tale, you know, it was the dream sure. that she was just this wonderful person. I don't think that helped. I think it was different. Mm. And I was searching for something which really was the colour, was the sight that... that I had. So I think there's a whole load of issues. It wasn't just one, but I think the lifestyle of growing up as a child who was different and really who wasn't understood and did have, you know, obviously mother issues certainly led to...
You had a hell of a time when you had a breakdown. Was that the lowest point? You know, everybody says that you always have to reach your lowest point in order to come back up again.
Yeah.
Would you say that was the point where you really were all-time low?
Most definitely, and that was a time that I knew I had a choice to live or die, and I certainly didn't want to live the way I was living, which was, you know, with this anger sure. and this frustration.
I mean, that's you with your wee girl. You've got two children.
But yes,
that's you with your wee girl. Did they help? Your children help you sort of claw your way back out again?
Oh, definitely. Mm. I mean, I looked at them and I didn't want to be angry at them, and I loved them. But there was huge triggers of how I behaved and treated them, you know, and how they treated me in sure. my childhood. And I was not ever taught, or I never knew how to be a mother, really.
No, I understand. I do understand difficult. What you're saying. It was almost a chance meeting that turned things around. You met this aromatherapist. You were saying you actually went for some treatment. Was that right? And
yeah.
And she kind of helped you. She sort of tapped into something, didn't she?
I mean, the hospitals couldn't deal with me. Mm. And it turned out I was having panic attacks, which I didn't even know what they meant. Mm. My heart was racing. They eventually put me on a heart monitor, and it was peaking to 150. And they gave me beta blockers. But somewhere along the line, I'd made the decision to live. And I was very lucky to see an advert for an aromatherapist, and I went to her.
And that really turned it around, because that's when you started talking about this sort of auras that you can see.
Yes.
And whatever people may
yes.
think, you can see them.
Yes.
You yes. see these things. And then did that sort of, was that like unlocking a key to you?
Absolutely,
do you think?
Because for the first time someone said, my goodness, you know, everything you've been through life, no wonder you're in the state you are.
Mm-hmm.
And then she understood what I was talking about
right.
when I told her I could see colour.
And you do help a lot of people. And you've got these three bottles here. This is part of the therapy, isn't it? This is only
yes.
a small selection.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of them. There's over, what, 40 odds?
There's 49.
49 bottles. People sit and talk to you.
Yes.
Using colour, if you like.
Yes.
You were saying that they pick four that they like and four that they don't
yes.
like. And then you can talk about it and get people to talk more.
Yes.
Is that really your mission in life? You want to help other people who have gone through what you've gone through to understand themselves?
There are so many people who do want to know more about themselves.
Mm.
So many people are searching for something, they don't know what.
Mm.
And at the moment, you know, with the increase of depression, suicides, cancer, there's a great need for us to transform our lives. And it is possible, you know, especially... I came down this road of being, you know, nothing and sitting in a void of nothingness. Mm. At school, being told I wasn't any good at English, to writing a book.
Well, yeah, you've written
a
book, and you've called it Dark Storm, Golden Journey. I mean, do you, even with all that's happened to you, you look back, you still think it's been a golden journey? Did you ever think you'd get to the situation you're in now?
I didn't know the situation I'm in now existed.
Right.
You know, it was, but there is this hope, there is this other way of living, and it's standing up and getting to know yourself and human behaviour and how we act and how we react, and it's wonderful, and certainly the colour plays an enormous role because it's a language, and so, you know, people can self-select their colours and know exactly what's going on for them and how they're behaving. And of course, we do aura drawing. We know what's going on
right.
on an emotional and on a physical level as well. And we also do this with animals. We're able to, you know, so many people have animals and they worry about their animals.
Mm-hmm.
So we're able to tap on a telepathic level and pick up and decode the frequencies.
Well, Alison, it's been fascinating talking to you. Good luck with the book, Dark Storm, Golden Journey. And
yeah.
thank you very much indeed for coming in.
Thanks.
Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Right, coming up next, fashion stylist Nicole Simmons with the latest in leather.
And the weather in Norwegian in a couple of minutes, so join us if you can.
So what basically you've got to do is draw a drawing.
Well, what we do is, this was the original drawing, which is very, very difficult to see. What happened was I have a Irish setters, and the Irish setter puppy was written off by the vet. She was lame, very lame. And we did every test that there was and couldn't find out what was wrong with her. The vet said I'd over-exercised her. And one night I was determined to paint, and this is what I painted. And a friend of mine noticed the actual face of the dog, and this is the back. So if we look here first, this is drawn blind. That's the tip of the nose. We're coming along the nose, and that's the head, and that's the eye.
I can't see that.
So it's very difficult to see. But she's sleeping.
Well, that's the dog's head.
Yeah.
Snout, yeah.
Oh, there's the dog's head.
There we go.
The eye is closed as a slit. Huh? And then she's curled in a ball. If you look at here, this is her back.
Mm-hmm.
And what I realised was I hadn't damaged her leg muscles by exercising her, as was the diagnosis. It was her back. That was actually a horse. And a horse. So
horse.
What I did with this, I took her I took her to somebody in who does manipulation on animals. In fact, sees about 600 odd horses a year. And exactly where this splash of pink is, which is the gap in her electromagnetic field, it was a trap nerve. So 10 minutes manipulation. Dog's fine. And then what happened was somebody arrived at my door and said, as you know, you find a lot of this funny. She said, I hear you dabble. And I... and she said, I need your help.
And she actually came to you for help.
She'd heard of me through somebody. And up until this point, I'd never even thought about animals. And she said, my horse is going to be put down. And she said, please help me. And so I went down. And all I thought was, because I'm also trained with a scientist on electrocrystal therapy.
That's right.
And we have this machine that can scan people and does accurately pick up where there are blockages within the person's system. Well, we were told we could scan animals. And when I came to scanning the horse, I didn't even know where to put the electrode. So I sent my daughter...
That's the bit that was wrong there.
Well, there was quite a lot wrong with this horse. So I sent my daughter up for my crayons, and I prayed, basically, because I really didn't... I thought if I could have done this for my puppy, perhaps I could do this for
the
horse. So I basically sat and prayed, and I picked up the crayons, and I looked at the horse that was standing, and I drew, and this is what I drew. And when I then talked to the owner, I suggested that the horse had a chest infection, which accurately it had. The main problem for this horse was severe arthritis of the knees.
How do you channel all these energies? How does it all work for you? How did you get this gift?
Well, I think that through my learning and my understanding is that every one of us and everything in life has a frequency. That everything has a colour, so we can translate, scientifically, we can translate colour into frequency. It is a scientific process. And therefore, we also have what we call an electromagnetic field.
Yeah,
we're very, very sensitive. And if someone is sitting with their back to our door and someone creeps in, you don't physically hear them, you know they're there, or you know if you're on a bus, if someone's watching you. So we have this intuition, telepathy, it's ancient. And what we really need to do is to develop it, and we can.
Well, we're going to be chatting a little bit more, but it's absolutely fascinating. But John, you're going to have to beat off.
Got to go to work. Got to open
well, thank you very much for coming and wishing us a happy birthday. And I'll see you on Wednesday when you're going to give us your recipe for your little bit of...
Well, we'll bring something else a bit special in the
because it's Chinese New Year, isn't it?
We'll bring something Chinese in as well.
Good. Well, thank you very much for coming in. On that, we're going to have to take a short break now, but please join me after these ads on this special Edinburgh Live Good Morning Edinburgh birthday show. I'll see you in a couple of minutes. There you go. Well, if you've just woken up this morning, you've been with us through the rest of this morning, then thank you very much for joining us. But if you have just tuned in, we've got Alison Demarco, who's chatting about auras, but she's chatting about
the drawings that you've got here about animals, Auras, mm-hmm. aren't you?
Yeah.
And you're making a sort of special request on Edinburgh Live. What do you need next Wednesday for our viewers to help you out on?
Well, we've made a video called The Introduction to the Language of Colour. And we also are putting on that a piece regarding aura drawing.
Okay.
And therefore, it would be good to have an animal, because, you know, I've got lots of animals, but uh-huh. I can't use my own.
Right.
Because we want to have an animal we've never seen before. But the animal does need to have something wrong with it.
Okay. Okay.
And preferably a small animal, because we're filming indoors, a dog, you know, or a cat.
Dog, cat, or... What about, I mean, a lot of other people keep gerbils and hamsters and things like that, I mean...
Yeah, but it's probably better that it's a dog or a cat.
All right then.
And it's this Wednesday.
It's okay, yeah. So it's this Wednesday. If you're free and you're able to do some filming with Alison, then give us a call here at Edinburgh Live, 01316228818. That's the number, 01316228818, which is on your screens now. And we will put you in contact with Alison. You can help her make that video. But there has to be something wrong with your animal. Well, Alison, thank you very much for coming in this morning. We've been chatting all about auras. Just show the camera again exactly the aura that we were talking about earlier on, which is this one, which is fascinating.
Well, this one I drew blind with the dog actually curled in a ball at my feet, and I was just determined to paint, so there wasn't any rhyme to reason what I was doing. But it was a friend who did notice, and that is the tip of her nose
that
working up
yep.
to the bridge, to the head, with the eye
closed. Yeah.
And in colour therapy, the throat chakra centre is blue, the heart is green, and I added this horrible, what I thought, yellow blob, and that's the central nervous system.
Well, thank you very much for coming in this morning. It was very nice to see you again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for everybody who's been watching us this morning on our birthday show, and remember, keep it tuned to Edinburgh Live. Bye-bye.